You guys see that guy in the Stormtrooper costume, man? That's pretty good.
Which one?
You know, it was the Stormtrooper inside a Stormtrooper outfit. It was just a Troshka Stormtrooper. That would be awesome. I want to see that.
I would not be really surprised. All the crazy metaphors.
Like, my favorite thing was the Deadpool dressed as Sailor Moon.
There is a guy that's usually walking around here in a red Adidas one, though.
Oh, yeah, Hip Hop Trooper. I love Hip Hop Trooper.
I also like Hawaiian.
Yeah,
shirt.
He's got the gold chain. I get that the boombox with him. I want that so bad.
Yeah. So hey,
what did Batman say to Robin before they got in the car? Get in the car. I got a million of them. And I'll keep them to myself.
Oh, no.
One more. Where's the fun in that?
Okay.
One more. Comedy Hour with Jonathan Strickland, everyone.
She read the guy that went to his therapist and he said, "Doctor, I think I'm a pup tent. No, I'm a teepee. No, I'm a pup tent. No, I'm a teepee." His therapist said, "Your problem is you're too tense."
Guy walks into a psychiatrist's office wearing a loincloth made out of saran wrap. The psychiatrist says, "Well, I can clearly see your nuts."
That's the quality you can look forward to on this panel.
That's it.
You too can make terrible jokes in amazing clarity
through the amazing world of podcasting.
Fast.
You guys about ready?
Sure. Are you moderating?
I'm not doing anything. I'll moderate. I can help you. I can help you along.
Don't make me pull this DragonCon over.
Are you moderating?
Apparently.
I know.
Good luck with that.
I'm so sorry.
That's fair.
One more minute.
Yeah, I have no knowledge about advanced.
You moderated last year and it was fine. Okay. So I don't know why you're like.
Was she here last year?
What?
So who's having a good DragonCon so far? Excellent.
Just being at DragonCon makes it a good DragonCon.
No.
Usually.
I've been to a lot of DragonCons. Most of them have been good ones.
You've been a lot more than I have. Yeah. So.
Who was here at the first DragonCon?
The first one year was that.
Being the
80s, 1987? No one's still alive. Who was alive back then?
Those were dog times.
Who here's father was Toastmaster at the first DragonCon?
Oh, this guy.
That's how I got to be at the first DragonCon. That was back when I was cute enough to be a guest under my dad's name, and now I have to do stuff so I can still be a guest. How fair is that?
Totally fair. Yeah. Like be on this panel?
Yep.
Where you have no knowledge?
Deep.
Of audio. Advanced audio production is this panel, and Jonathan Strickland, you're up here because of your expertise in advanced audio production.
My expertise is sitting on this side of the microphone and talking into it, so I'll be asking a lot of questions.
Right.
Here's the thing. I work for HowStuffWorks.com. I do podcasts like Tech Stuff, Forward Thinking. I do a show called Brain Stuff. Occasionally I show up on some of the other stuff shows. And the wonderful advantage I have is that because I work for How Stuff Works, and How Stuff Works is a sizable company, and we do these podcasts as part of what we do, we have producers who are dedicated to making sure we sound great. And so for me, all of that weight is taken off. So I will be asking a lot of questions about how do they make me sound great? Because you already can hear what the bass line is.
Yeah, so. You have the experience of working with an experienced professional crew, so I think that's probably unique compared to most of the people
I'll say
here.
An experienced crew.
maybe not professional.
I mean, it all depends
Fair
on
enough.
Whether or not my producer is eating while we're talking.
Now, Steve, tell us a little about yourself. What do you do? You are a professional, right?
You're giving me a little too much credit, maybe.
Professor, you have cards.
Come on. I pretend to be. No. I'm Steve Riekeberg. I am a podcaster and audio engineer. That's my technical background. I do freelance audio production pretty much full-time. I work for Scott Sigler. I work for McMillan's Quick and Dirty Tips Network. I work for other shows. I produce like 12 podcasts a week or something. So,
very good. Aaron?
Yes. My name is Aaron Littleton. I produce the Einstein Simplified podcast, which is a short-form improv comedy podcast out in Oxville. Also work with John here for a long-form YouTube series called Aaron and John Watch, where we take a TV show theme song, we put it on loop for an hour, and we
go crazy for an hour.
Wow.
Wait,
and we basically
not killed yourselves yet? I've gotten close to getting Aaron gouged your ears out.
We just did the Hercules theme song like from the 90s,
right.
And that was tough to make it through.
How long does the average theme last?
Not long enough.
Right.
by the end of it, it feels like about 15 seconds, and you're like,
right.
Oh god,
we
4 minutes, we gotta watch it 16 more times.
We've decided the official theme song length should be about 30 minutes.
Exactly.
So like just encompass the whole TV episode.
I think your show needs a new title. The Two Masochists.
That's basically what it is. But when you watch it with us, it's slightly less terrifying.
Only slightly.
Non-audio-wise, I also run a Tumblr called The Same Picture of Dave Coulier Every Day, which is weird.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Weird at all. I'm going to go back to the theme song thing, because that interests me greatly. Do you do stuff from the 80s and 90s? Is there a difference in length back then? Because it felt like it was more impactful back then, but was it any longer or was it shorter? Do you really know? Do you really put
sometimes down? Sometimes a little longer. We've only done a few of these so far, but most of the ones like from the 90s are usually about a minute and a half. We did the My Little Pony one, like a couple, and that was about 45 seconds, 30 seconds
I'm
maybe.
I'm so sorry.
But,
can you hum it for us or give us a few of the lines? Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. We do a lot of the ones from the 90s because that's what people are particularly nostalgic about.
They really
days.
Are. People have, yeah, the 90s have shot through the roof recently. I guess those kids in the 90s are coming of age and getting old.
Yeah,
and nostalgic.
Yeah.
Darn rascals.
Right. Anybody up here from the 90s? Kind of grew up here in the 90s?
Yeah. I guess, yeah.
People? Are you going to just...
Hands up 90s?
Do you want to go back another couple
10,
decades?
70s? Big 70s guy? Yeah. 80s? Yeah, that's when I grew up. All right. You have to talk to you.
Generation X. I bridged the two.
Yeah. Generation X. Steve, so give us your... What's been some challenges you've had with the shows you're doing? Has there been any, like, outstanding stories?
I don't have any outstanding stories, but I have plenty of pet peeves that I facepalm every time, and I still have to make it sound good, polishing a turd sometimes.
Right. Well, you know, I always think these technical podcasts, mm-hmm. usually when I see the audience, I'm assuming they probably are all invested greatly. You guys, mm-hmm. podcasts, looking at doing the editing, doing that stuff?
I'm the one.
You're the one. You're the one. So if you guys have questions or just want to open up round table discussions.
Yeah, whole idea of this panel isn't just us rambling at you guys. It's very Q&A, round table discussion is kind of the whole thing we want to do. So
totally. Jonathan, you have something on your mind.
Oh, well, here's a simple question that maybe everyone here already knows the answer to, but I'll just pose it as if I did not know the answer.
And so I've heard stories from people, they'll put, you know, moving blankets up on the walls to dampen the sound, or, you know, use excessive noise reduction, and because they're using the wrong tool for the job.
Right.
I had a Yeti mic, which, I mean, I love the Yeti. It's very easy to use, but the issue was that I would sometimes be recording in my house, which is it's the style of a European flat. It's got several floors. All of the floors are not that big, so it's not like I'm in a huge room. But any sound in my house, whether it was a floor up, a floor down on the same floor, if my wife accidentally knocked a penny off a counter and it was across the house, it would pick up on that microphone. And it was just one of those things. I said, well, I love the sound that this is picking up, but unfortunately it's picking up every sound in my house. You can hear when my dog is walking around, all of
that. Yes, sometimes less sensitive ends up sounding better because there's not all this extra stuff.
Yeah.
It's much more focused to just your voice.
Right. You guys...
There was a question in there, something specifically. And a couple years ago, this would have been a tough question to answer, what to recommend, because I'm sure some of you guys are interested in this. Audio Technica, I think it's the... Is it the ATR 2100?
It's... I think I have the 2000, but...
Maybe it's the 2000.
Also...
The great thing, they make one, it's USB, but it's also XLR, so if you want to... You can start out with just the microphone, has a headphone amp, so you can still monitor live in real time. But if you want to upgrade to a mixer, you don't have to replace your microphone, which is... I think there's very few out there that are dual use like that, and it's... You're not, you know...
And it's really reasonably
it's
priced.
I'll say it's like $35, $30.
Amazon runs...
Yeah, they have
all the time.
Deals on it all the time. Yeah. If it's not that cheap now, it probably will be like next week.
And that is the kind of microphone I use now instead of the condenser mic, and the difference is remarkable. So
right. So as podcasters, we don't always have a large budget to work with. Sometimes we have no budget. Sometimes we just have... Maybe you picked up a microphone at the yard sale.
Or maybe you're using your laptop's built-in microphone.
Laptop built-in microphone. So
trying to connect through Skype to all your friends from across, like trying to get everyone in
right?
on this podcast.
Right. So as a podcaster who had no absolute direction when I started out, I had a couple of little microphones that were just crap. I don't even remember what brand they were. They were just so off-brand, it was probably insane. I probably picked up at a yard sale somewhere.
It's actually just a megaphone.
It's probably just a megaphone. And but I remember that I had to be creative because there was no indication that what I was doing was going to be worth anything, because this was 2005. So podcasting, when someone said the word podcasting, it really meant nothing really. And so they
either go, huh, or they go,
right.
I don't have an iPod.
Yeah, and we had no idea what it was going to be, or because we were still making it. We were still trying to figure out what this
making
whole thing
this
was.
One, yeah.
And I didn't really worry too much about the equipment. I just worried about testing and fooling around, because I'm a fiddler. Is anybody else a fiddler out there? Kind of, yeah, you get something cheap, and it's like, you know, I'll make it work. It's my time is worth nothing, but, you know. So I've got this cheap thing, so I will sit there, and I remember some of the things I did was I learned that if I turn my mixer down, because I picked up a cheap mixer, if I turn the gain down really low and I just got close to the microphone and talked, then I wasn't picking up anything in the background, and I wasn't getting any echo.
Microphone technique is important.
Right. Mm-hmm. So it was a matter of doing, but I had to be like this.
For these type of microphones, are most anyone a podcaster would want to use,
right.
Don't
be back here. You want to be...
Yeah, that's
this is the
do.
Great rule of thumb, 4 to 6
right.
inches.
Do like you're talking
to
the thumb.
Thumb
and then,
if you're within that distance, you're safe, and it's really makes it simple. You don't have to think about it.
We got some. There's some creative thought here, or some
awesome.
Questions from Mario. Mario, you're going to come up a little closer because that's as much cord as I got.
That could have been
that
cordly, which is also a good thing.
Which I have as well, which I love.
Okay, I'll have to do the SM58 then.
I love the
question
SM58,
is,
sure.
First of all, I'm in a house environment. Yeah, I'm kind of following hard times, living with the folks, really fussy about what kind of acoustic treatment I can put up. And I pretty much have nothing, and I'm getting a lot of, I produce music.
Okay.
So I'm getting a lot of artificial bass in the background, so I have no, my mixes sound great on my monitors and terrible on my iPod headphones.
Mm.
But it's one of those, how to eliminate the extra bass bounce I get from the plaster in the room, and without making the room look like crap.
Oh, that is...
How to deaden without...
Yeah, I mean, I'd say bass traps for what you're doing, but I mean, that's...
So you're taking the bass trap route, then you're...
For those that aren't familiar, you see, you know, acoustic foam. There's actually one of the issues, especially in a square room like this, is that those bass frequencies will get stuck in the corners, and
right.
keep echoing off, bouncing between the building up, so you have all this bass buildup on the bottom end that... can get really annoying, and that's what bass traps are designed to diffuse that. So in many
right.
cases, that's more important than having the other acoustical panels, because
right.
the bass frequencies have more energy than the higher frequencies. So
if you've watched, I've got some more questions, I want to make a quick comment, but I have also the SM58, which I'm using right here. I changed to a different mic, but I went back to this because it always seems comfortable to me. It's a very good vocal mic.
And it's kind of amazing, because that's been pretty much a standard for 40
right.
years and counting. I mean, they haven't really changed the design at all. It's still rugged as all get out. It's still
right. And if you watch
sounds,
if you watch
plenty good enough,
right. If you watch Musicians yeah, Friend,
that's
which is a website. Yeah, yeah. If you watch that, and you can pick it up for about. I think I picked up one for like $68 one time.
So yeah, sometimes you can get special deals, yeah, but it's usually $100.
Right.
Sometimes they'll do like a $10 off thing, but it's not bad at all for yeah. really what you're asking. Like I said, it'll last 40 years.
Right, exactly.
Yeah. Exactly, yes. Exactly. The whole joke, you can hammer nails with a 58, yeah.
Do you guys have any thoughts about a sort of portable sound booth? I've seen people creating them.
Right.
The small squares. I don't know if it's effective. Also, I mean, just going into your car, I guess, is the next.
Actually,
I thought this is really good. Getting in the car.
That's a good. Yeah. That's really the portable sound booth thing. I'm not too big on because usually, the foam. I mean, you know, you're building like a little storage crate and you're putting acoustic foam panels in there, but that's usually thin. You know, 1 to 2 inches. So you're only keeping out any, you're only dealing with any high frequency. So any of those lower bass frequencies are just going to go right through it and it won't change anything. So it's not going to have as much of an impact. Any car made in the last handful of years had so much sound deadening that that can be a legitimate option if that's a major concern for you. But
laptop and
yeah,
a simple USB mic.
But honestly, yeah, I mean, if you feel you need something like that, like a porta booth or recording in your car, that might be. Maybe you need to look at what equipment you're using and if there's something better suited for your environment.
However, if you are recording from inside your car, you can totally make your podcast really stand out by talking about from the inside of your car. I mean, sometimes that sort of depends on the podcast, obviously, but sometimes that sort of thing, as silly as it sounds.
As long as you're not in the trunk.
Well,
the trunk cast?
I'm inside someone's car. I don't know where we're going. Yeah. But depending upon, yeah, it could be like, when I get there, I'll give you a guess of where I'm at. No, I think that sort of thing you can really connect with your audience too. And I know that isn't really what we're covering here, but
I'd say there's something similar to that. It's like if you're going on like location, you're probably trying to capture some amount of essence of the people that are there. The worst thing in the world is to set a microphone in front of somebody and they're like, "Wow, it's a microphone," and they lose that authenticity you're trying to capture. And a portable sound booth. It's also going to be something completely foreign. Mm-hmm. Yeah, a Honda Fit they're comfortable in. Your weird, like, plywood
like
and your form factor.
Yeah, okay, well, there you go.
My family's livelihood is
yeah.
Honda,
so
you
might
that.
Get some more authenticity out of the people itself, not necessarily the audio, but for the people. Yeah.
How do you convince people to get in your car?
Well, I
not
find...
Not creepy at all.
Then the audio quality doesn't matter, so
she's not available, you can actually use some sugar.
On the lady's problem with the bass trap, I narrate audiobooks, but when I started, and I use a whisper room now, mm-hmm. but when I started, I had that problem with bass rumble. Right. And I bought a number of polyethylene mm-hmm. foam pillows and stacked them in the mm-hmm. corners, and believe it or not, it worked great.
Yeah, it can be kind of trial and error, but you can do it yourself without having to spend a ton of money, or at least get something that will approximate the results of a professionally designed and installed setup.
If you do come up here, be sure to tell us what podcast you do and that kind of stuff too, so we can all listen to it, so we can get an example of what you got going on.
Shameless plug time.
I don't do any podcasts.
Actually, apparently not shameless.
I solely record audiobooks for ACX.
You got a website for that?
Which are distributed no.
Oh, well, crap. Now you need to go make one to promote it.
I'm Ken Stevens, and most of what I do is non-technical.
Mm-hmm. Right.
A lot of medical, business.
Right.
Interesting.
Math.
Math.
I got started voluntarily recording for Learning Ally, which is a nonprofit for students who are blind.
Oh,
and because of that, one of the CEOs of a publishing company had a daughter who was dyslexic who was using my audiobooks, and he said, "I want to find the guy who recorded
that."
Cool. And that was the start. And so
nice.
Now I do a lot.
It's a great story.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you.
Hey, Charles, with do most of my production with Entrepreneurs Workshop and Entrepreneur Radio, that host. from the helicarrier.
A bunch of accessories.
I'm toning it down, just to add
from
more
the
lighter.
What's that? Yeah.
He's from the helicarrier, a serial podcaster.
Dunaway listened to for one episode and said, "This sucks." Quit listening. Nice show about Marvel Avengers Alliance, and we're going to be talking about something next panel going on with that. But for my client on Rear's Workshop, I had to come up with a way. I had to solve this problem. I want to see if you had any suggestions. I'll leave it to you there. They wanted multi-track recording. They wanted it to be in Miami where they're based, and they wanted to have their guests anywhere in the world where they're based. Mm-hmm. So Skype, right?
Right.
And they wanted to multi-track it. And I know what I came up with, but I'm curious to hear what you guys would suggest for multi-tracking on Skype.
I mean, honestly, yeah. I mean, use a proper FireWire multi-track mixer. One of the clients I work with, I love it because they have a bunch of people, and they have usually 3 to 4 people in studio, and they actually have like a proper space now where they set it all. It's pretty. Their neighbors think they're a porn studio, hilarious, because there are cameras and lights and everything. Right. But so there's 3 or 4 of them in studio, and then there's remote hosts on Skype, and there's remote guests on Skype, and if I didn't have multi-track from them, especially on Skype, because some people, they're, you know, you can hear all this background noise or their dog barking or whatever. So the great thing about multi-track is if you can get it, you can isolate a lot of that stuff and clean it up. But it is a more significant monetary investment to get a proper multi-track mixer, especially because there were some USB 2.0 ones that went away. Some of the FireWire brands went out. Of course, it's also, it's FireWire, which isn't super common anymore.
Right.
But that,
you're talking about they're in, they multi-track where they are and they say,
Yeah. I get it over Dropbox. Now, admittedly, it's over 5 gigs of audio.
Sure.
Because it's uncompressed, but right. it's eight tracks. But
well, mine was a little different. I had to be the engineer and everything
right.
in Atlanta while they did that. Ultimately got a.
Honestly, I wish I was there with their because their guy he tries, but he doesn't know what he's doing really.
I think if you're using Adobe Audition, there's actually a setting for one of the tracks where you can use your computer's speaker audio as an input. So you could use whatever inputs they've got coming in as the one of the speakers and or one of the tracks, and then the Skype call itself would just record through the computers. I mean, it's not picking up their microphone, it's literally just plugging that right in.
Splitting each?
Yeah, every single voice has its own track.
You really want exactly. Because having
they
that all summed down,
you can't
fix that. It's all pretty much burned into what it's going to be when it's all summed down to stereo or mono.
Right. Well, what I ended up having to do, they bought a mixer, it's a Behringer 24 or 8, something like that. It had 8 direct outs.
Right.
So I could do multiple computers from multiple Skypes.
So it was an 8 bus. That was probably a bit of a pain, yeah.
Yeah, well, they paid for it, so I could figure it out.
But as opposed to getting like a single multi-track feed, yeah.
And if I have time later, I'm gonna come back up and ask about the LUFs and those kind of things.
Actually, to add to what he was saying, I found the same thing when I was starting to do my podcast.
Which is?
loosestaples.com, filmdispenser.com. I actually have cards if anyone wants.
Cool.
But yeah, because I work on a Mac and trying to record Skype, because it's just 2 of us on the podcast, but trying to record the Skype audio and my audio and then blend it together and not use the actual Skype audio.
Yeah.
It was interesting because there was like a software mixer I had to use.
Yeah,
and
the thing about using that stuff
is
some of it works younger. And also, Skype has kind of deprecated their API, though it still sort of works. So anyway, the whole thing of these software recording and virtual audio cable solutions is either, you know, they will break without notice when they update the software or update the OS, or if you can afford it, have a mixer with a proper mix minus setup. That's gonna work pretty much forever, you know. Even if you move from Skype to, you know, whatever the next big thing that replaces Skype, you know, would be.
Yeah.
But.
So I mean, right now it's my friend who's doing the editing, but I'm getting ready to start a new podcast in the fall covering all of the DC television series.
Nice.
And the Loose Staples is a comic book podcast, by the way.
Very good.
So my problem is similar to some other folks that I live in an apartment. I've got a Rode podcaster. I've got it on an arm. With the spider stand to help limit the vibrations. But I've had a hard time with, if I turn the gain all the way up on the computer, it seems to pick everything up.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, even being a dynamic mic, it still seems to pick up a lot of the background noise. I'm in an apartment. I've got upstairs neighbors that I think heard elephants.
Right.
The air conditioner running, the whatever, and if I turn the gain down on the on my MacBook, whoever I'm talking to on Skype seems to have a hard time hearing me, and I, then I feel like I'm doing a lot in post-production and pick up even more background noise. So
anytime you're amplifying it in post, it's going to be worse because you're amplifying any preamp noise too at that stage.
You can probably do some subtractive. I know when I use Reaper from the majority of what I work with, and there's a VST.
It's
free for evaluation.
It's basically Nagware, and you're supposed to buy it, but it will let you. It'll nag you, but it'll let you run it. I think I have like a 18-month-old installation of Reaper that still works.
It's like WinRAR, like 400,000 days.
Yeah, exactly.
Every time you start up, it makes 30 seconds.
Day 830.
To be fair though, I did. It's only $50 for a license for personal use.
Yeah,
it's fantastic.
Unless you're making, I think it's like five.
Grand.
Yeah, I was gonna say at least five figures. You know, then they want like 300, which is still perfectly reasonable.
Exactly.
But, but if you're like just a hobbyist, it's totally not like, at all expensive. It's not the most easiest or prettiest to use software, but it is as powerful as any of the main names like Pro Tools or Audition.
I luckily bought Creative Cloud for Dreamweaver, which Audition came out on, so I figured I'd put it to dual use.
Yes, definitely. Thank you.
Bruce Sheffer, Tri-Tech Games Podcast. We have four hosts on different parts of the country. We record over Skype. We all use, except for one of us uses, because he has a Mac, use iFree Skype Recorder. We each record our individual tracks. They're all sent to me, which I put them all together using Audacity. Basically, we record stereo so that if someone talks over somebody, I usually have a track where they didn't do that.
Right.
And also, in case somebody doesn't record, their track dies.
Mm-hmm.
So I have something as a backup. I put it together, put it all down to a mono, run it through Levelator, and then basically put a front end on it. So we use blue snowball mics with the 10 dB setting, if we can get people to do that. So what are we doing wrong?
So
there's no wrong way. There might be recommended ways, but I wouldn't say wrong per se.
I
mean, it's just ultimately, are you happy with the results?
Ultimately, I'm the editor, so I'm never happy with the results.
Fair enough. Honestly, I'm not sure if I was talking with you about it, but that's one of my biggest thing. People that want to get better, just listen critically. Does this sound good? Objectively, does this sound good? Why does it not sound good? And that is really the path to learning this stuff. I mean, of course, you can hire me or something, but I mean, a lot of it is having that discerning, the discernment of wanting to get better and recognizing there's a problem.
Is there actually any decent sound noise suppression software that can be used in post?
There is. I'm very hesitant to recommend it as a rule because it tends to get abused, and it gets used tends to be used as a sledgehammer more than a scalpel, because it's noise reduction, not noise removal, for a reason. Noise reduction works by removing frequencies, essentially. So it's essentially just trying to make it not sound terrible while removing all that extra stuff. But the more you remove, the more of the signal, even 12.5, you could even start rolling it off. So that's a nice thing, especially if you do need to use noise reduction, at least you've already removed all that those frequencies that are aren't really important.
What was that range you just said you should be within?
Oh, as far as...
The
frequency spectrum, it's just ballpark, but actually a lot of mixers will have a low cut. It's a 70 at 75 hertz, you know, it's a 18 octave, which will roll it off gently enough so it's not like it goes from sound, no sound. It rolls off. But I'd say, you know, anything, you know, you can set a 75 hertz low cut gentle enough, and then
that's what my low cut button is on my.
Yeah.
That's what I need to press. And what am I suppressing there? Am I suppressing dogs barking? Am I suppressing airplanes?
More microphone bums or noisy neighbors next door.
Okay.
Especially maybe someone like you that has a deeper voice. There is some frequencies there, but for most people,
right,
there isn't nearly that much to make it.
Only my cats can hear it.
Maybe, right. I don't know.
And
but
the high level?
Certainly anything above 16 kilohertz, you know, probably you could say, you know, 15, 14. I mean, that's where most of that is where you see, in fact, 128 kilobit MP3 typically throws out anything above 16K, okay. Which gives you an idea.
Who
so.
Pushes their low cut and off and on their equalizer besides me just pushes on, says, what does this do? I can't tell what it does. It's not doing anything.
If you don't, I would probably recommend it, because right. Usually it can help keep problems from happening.
Mario?
Just a quick question. Let's say, I know a lot of things in cooking, they'll, instead of measuring, they'll just start tossing spices in and to taste. So
right.
I'm kind of wondering, is it acceptable in this case just to loop a portion of the audio and just start slowly cutting and basically earing the sound until what you have is gone without cutting out your signal?
Yeah, I mean, that's really the way you do it. If you're setting up any sort of, you know, plugins or effects on it, highlight a section, highlight the offending section and loop it and play with those settings. I mean, that's the way the pros do it. I mean, to get things dialed in.
I love my parametric EQ, just saying.
Oh, there you go, yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
So is that what Audacity is doing whenever I tell it to suppress the noise? It says, give me about 2 or 3 seconds of room noise and it'll kind of go through and does it automatically.
Kind of a different
it's kind
exam.
Of a different thing.
Yeah,
see, but, I don't know anything.
Andrew Wilson. I do not currently podcast, but
long time volunteer at the podcasting track, so
that's
you
true.
Practically
I,
are.
I do a fair bit of audio editing,
sure.
And the question I have is about software and not so much the cost of it, but the time. So I have access to a complete Adobe Creative Suite. Should I take the time to learn to use Audition,
mm-hmm.
or can I stick with, you know, Audacity?
It really depends. I mean, I use Audition and I like it, but it really ultimately depends. Are you happy with what you're getting out of Audacity? And it does have some weaknesses, but it is fairly simple, which can make things easier depending on what you're trying to do. I don't think I can answer that for you, but I do think you have a lot more flexibility when you move up to a proper digital audio workstation like Audition, whether it's Audition or Reaper or Pro Tools or some of the other ones that I can't even think of that are also out there. You have more flexibility as far as plugins and having real-time effect changes and all sorts of stuff. Those sounds all complicated, but it's the same paradigm no matter the software you're using when you get to that level.
If you have access to the Adobe Creative Suite, you may already be familiar with some of the other Adobe products like Photoshop.
Yeah.
One of the nice things I like about Audition is it, and to some degree, it has Photoshop tools in it.
Healing brush.
Yeah, it's got a healing brush in it.
Yeah,
there's
yeah.
There's a whole graphical
Audition,
area.
One of the things I love about Audition that I don't really think any other software that I can think of does is Spectral View. So you can, normally you're seeing a waveform view, you can go to Spectral View and you can see the frequencies, and usually if there's a glaring issue, you can physically see it.
Gold,
that's true, okay. There's a healing brush, just like you might, you know, clean out for imperfections in Photoshop, you can do it in Audition, and it'll kind of do its best to try and remove that. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't work as well, but it's an interesting tool to have for sure.
But it's nice you don't have to, like, you take Reaper. I mean, I came from a graphic design background, and when I started working in I use Soundbooth too, but also Audition. Mm-hmm. It just feels like an Adobe product you've used for
sure.
Years.
Yeah.
I mean, it has effects.
Yeah,
just
especially
like
since
Adobe After Effects.
Adobe did it again from the ground up, so it matches all the other Creative Suite stuff. The thing about Audition is Audition has been pretty much the standard in most radio stations for editing for years and years. But before it was called Audition, before Adobe bought it was Cool Edit Pro.
And I used that quite a bit, actually.
Yeah, and then they basically renamed Cool Edit 2000 Adobe Audition 1.0, and then they didn't really change it was still that old 20-year-old probably code until a couple years ago, but. Anyway, it's definitely what I use. So,
Jonathan, do you have to use any brain power when you're recording? I mean, do you get to just sit back now, or do you have to focus?
Okay, so if you're actually talking about the process of recording, that has been taken care of for me from start to finish. But I actually do research my shows, Brian, if that's what you're suggesting. I mean, Tech Stuff is like an hour-long show where we talk about,
Wait, you don't? You don't?
No.
What's the fun of that?
Switch it up. Well, first, you can always YouTube your software to see if it's familiar to you. You know, that way you don't just jump in.
That's
and
a good point. There are people out there, and I wouldn't always wholeheartedly endorse taking some people's recommendations.
The,
random people on YouTube, but you definitely see people demonstrating stuff, and you can kind of see, does this... It's a very personal thing, you know. Do you kind of intuitively get some of these interface design decisions?
Which is why I like Reaper.
So,
there's podcasts out there.
It's a very personal thing. I mean, ultimately, 90% of those same features and abilities are in these different programs. They just may implement it a different way or it looks different, but you can still do it. So a lot of it is, what are you most comfortable with?
What was that sidebar conversation you just had?
Sign Language is a podcast by Bruce Williams about Adobe Audition.
Right, okay.
So let's talk loudness for a minute. Cause, you know, every podcast is either quiet or loud. And I went through a seminar lately, but I want to hear your Johnson's recommendation on anybody, actually. Of course, we know DB. So where's your target first? Where's your target DB? Mm-hmm. And if you want to wait, I'll hold off the others, but there's some other loudness questions. But, you know, high pass filter.
Yeah.
I'm throwing out all these Ks. And I'm with you, though. It's like, the K. Ooh. But my high pass filter goes from the number 20 to 120. So I've been told to put it like 120. So that helps.
In that ballpark, I mean, it just depends on how much you want to shave off.
Okay. They were just saying it helps take that bass off, give you headroom.
It rolls off that bass. That's not so.
So what's your target DB when you're mixing the voices? Right. And then what's are you familiar with LUFS?
I live by that.
Why don't you explain that for us?
So there's different ways for metering and monitoring levels. You have most of you are probably familiar with some form of peak level. You know, don't go over zero. You probably want to be recording, you know, within -6, -12, so you have a little bit of headroom if you get overexcited and you're not clipping. But you also have something like RMS, which essentially mathematical average of the volume over the whole thing, but it's depending on, you know, if you have this really loud part and a really quiet part, it's just the average, so it doesn't always give the best representation as far as a number. It can be a little misleading. So, but LUFS is, I don't even remember what it stands for, but it's...
Does anybody remember what LUFS is?
It's a more recent kind of international standard for loudness, and you can get a pretty more representative number. So I usually target -16 or around there. You don't really need to go a lot higher than that. I mean, a lot of popular music is mixed to like -5. It's ridiculous. And that just means just like wall of sound. You don't really want to do that. But you want to have enough so that you don't have people reaching for the volume knob all the time. So
that's a good question. Yes, sir, come on up.
Brand new British Invaders podcast.
All right.
After I don't know how many years, I switched from dynamic mics to condenser mics, which I'm satisfied with so far, and I'm doing okay at filtering out the excess with a few different things. Starting to play with working with that to fine tune a little more and play with some other things, in part for the podcast, where I have one track recorded locally, one track recorded remotely, dual ender Skype, that sort of thing. And I'm starting to look at things like exciters, and I'm wondering about where you stand on exciters, other tools like that. Mm-hmm. What would you use for playing with what you can use to tweak things?
Are you thinking of like specific plugins, or? Because really the main two out there, it's funny because they're basically just plug-ins based off of two, there are two main companies that produce hardware rack mount exciters, and they both work in very different ways. There's DBE Sonic Maximizer, and there's, I just blanked out on the other
John,
one.
John, do you know what an exciter is?
But anyway, what an exciter does, it by creating high frequency harmonics, it kind of See, this is way super technical, even for me as an engineer to explain. Yeah. But honestly, I wouldn't say it's that essential. A lot of the times you'll see it more used for music or for PA to enhance the kind of punch and intelligibility, but I think sometimes it can just make voice, it can negatively impact voice, especially if it's turned too, if there's too much of the exciter there.
As something to play with, just with the plugin?
If you want, yeah, I mean, just as with anything, use with moderation.
Okay, cool, thanks.
Thank you. Mario's back.
Yes, I'm back, and I'm actually just bouncing, I have a few questions based on a couple other questions that came before me.
Does that mean we didn't, if I didn't answer the question, great, I'm sorry.
No, I'm thinking, well, I'm no expert, I'm just a guy who's trying to get his album done, and I've learned a lot of stuff along the way, taking courses. My guess, and I'm giving educated guesses, and I just want to bounce them off you, and hopefully if I can answer these guys' questions by doing that.
Sure.
I'm guessing if you're having trouble with volume on spoken word, wouldn't you just be able to even add just some light compression on there and just turn up the the gain on the compression?
I mean, what I'm doing, especially for any of the vocal tracks, I'll have some compression on there. I'll have, you know, expander, gate, compressor, and then I'll have a master bus for the final compressor to make sure everything relative to each other is all at the proper level. So
I want to make the listener's ears bleed.
Oh yeah, no, but I mean, still, even with that, it's only going down to, you know, like I said, my target is -16 at the loudest, which is still very moderate for, it's -16 lufs, I should say. So it's not like I said, popular music is so over compressed to be unlistenable, and it's, so I am very, that is a pet peeve of mine, so I do not go crazy with it. But I certainly need some compression to tame those dynamic differences between really quiet and really loud.
Yeah, I know a lot of my own music, I actually need to lower the compression because it's starting to sound a bit flat.
Much compression, everything sounds all the same, and you tend to lose a lot of that higher frequency. That's why if you listen to any sort of, like I said, popular music, like a lot of like cymbal hits and stuff can sound really harsh. That's because of over compression, largely.
And cymbals.
Is it from the bass? Wouldn't it also nerf the bass as well?
It can, yeah.
One other, this is actually from the person who came in front of me. You're talking about harmonic exciters, and if I think what they're talking about is also true about just adding harmonics to the sound, what about just using something like a soft saturator? I know there's one French company called Ohmforce.
Yeah, that's another way. I mean, it's not necessarily always called an exciter, but it really, that is, the old tape saturation emulation stuff, That's something you can do, but I actually don't currently, I mean, I have such plugins, but I don't really use them because they're not necessarily necessary. I mean, it also depends if there's something lacking in your original signal. You know, if you need to try and, recreate, something that wasn't there in the original recording because maybe you didn't have the best microphone or whatever, but...
Well, the only reason I do it is because I take a virtual acoustic bass and it sounds rather plain. I want it to sound very evil and devilish, so...
Hey, I use GarageBand a lot on my Mac, and it does a whole bunch of, I do the male podcast filter on that. You know what I'm talking about?
There's male podcast.
Right. Does that automatically add all the compressor?
I
am also reading minds.
I don't normally, that's funny, because I do use Logic for one of my clients, which is the same engine as GarageBand. It's just the kitchen sink interface, basically. You can open GarageBand projects in Logic, and it's kind of bizarre, honestly.
Give us your question before he answers it. Give the question quick.
Jeff, 8-bit radio. I use GarageBand. Is there any advantage for me to move to, say, Audition? I don't have any experience working with Audition, so is there a large learning curve? Am I going to be completely lost?
Are you happy with what it sounds
like? Yeah, ultimately, are you happy with the results? Do you have any major annoyances with your editing process? If you're totally happy with it, there's nothing wrong. GarageBand isn't going away anytime soon.
Well, I make a lot of mistakes because I'm really bad at stuff. We do everything.
Why do you think I'm an audio engineer? I can edit out all my mistakes.
Plus, if you've got a good environment, if you're in a good place to record and you don't have a lot of issues with the original recording, GarageBand's plenty.
Yeah. That's a good point. Like, one of Audition's, for example, strengths is
repairing audio that has issues. But if you don't have all those issues, I mean, you don't have as much of a need for something like that.
Yeah, it does a good job.
Cool. Surprising. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Yeah, thank you.
If it works, if you're happy with it, I think ultimately that's the biggest thing. For people tend to get so wrapped up in going to the next, what they see as the next step, but it's not always, you don't need to do that necessarily.
Yeah, as long as you're comfortable with it.
Yeah, are you comfortable with it? Are you happy with the results? Yeah.
And podcasts have like sort of a high barrier of entry. I mean, if someone's listening to your podcast, it's because they've sought you out or they've sought the subject matter out that you podcast about. And to a degree, it's like, how many times have you turned off a podcast because it sounded bad? Like, I've done it, but
I'm a snob, though.
But like, to some degree, that's a, you get to a certain level, and like beyond that, I mean, it's always nice to be have a better sounding podcast. But as long as it's not running your listeners off,
yeah, having the perfect sound isn't going to get you more listeners.
Pop filters, please.
Oh, good God!
Yes, yes.
That is my. That is a. Oh, that's been me the past few weeks editing out for a project.
Stop eating spaghetti.
And all
Tuesday was banging my head against the desk.
Know where your mute button is another key.
Sure.
I love my friend dearly. It's his podcast. I'm his co-host for right now. But he leaves his phone, even on vibrate on the desk, and you hear it vibrate. He's using a blue snowball.
Ooh,
and I've got to tell him, put the phone on the floor or something so it doesn't go off in the middle of the podcast. but to the gentleman with the GarageBand, I noticed, because when I started, I was looking at GarageBand because everything was like, oh, GarageBand, Blue Yeti.
Yeah, certainly in the early days, that was kind of one of the only applications that really had any catered at all to us. So
but
I totally, yeah.
Most recent release, they ganked all the podcasts. Oh,
there's
yeah,
no default
true. Podcast
yeah.
settings. So if you're starting out, see if someone's got some basics, you know, that say, hey, here's some basic settings to do podcasting, because I couldn't find anything at the time. And I'm like, ah, I've got Creative Cloud, like I said, I'll do Audition just because it's there. I'm hoping Apple goes back and fix it, but I think they're trying to push people to Final Cut.
Right.
So it's my question, like, starting out, baseline, I just want to throw this up on the web 10 minutes after I recorded it, not go through a whole lot of editing. In Audition specifically, or more generically, if you've got other suggestions, what are some good things just to kind of real quick throw in some generic filters, maybe do some background cleanup? You know, like I said, I've got noise problems. Just to kind of get the voice levels
right.
cleaned up and get it, just so I can throw it up on the web with the least amount of work if I'm trying to push them out quickly.
Yeah, I mean, for most of them, I mean, the most time consuming thing is listening the whole thing, especially when you have like a 2-hour show, like some of my clients are just crazy to edit, is going through it and editing out all those issues. If you're just, but for most of the stuff, I'm putting more or less the same effects, you know, it's like, okay, vocal track gets this, this is, you know, the music they play live, so I treat that differently, and then the master final output has this. But yeah, I mean, start out with an EQ, even if it's only to, or at least an EQ to remove, you know, that low cut, high cut, to remove any of that needless frequencies, and then that's when I would probably do your noise reduction. Then you can look at, you know, an expander or noise gate, and then a compressor. That order, because, like, you know, the compressor will, the makeup game will bring up the overall level. So if you haven't already gated out and done noise reduction, it'll just make the noise more prevalent. But
there are some features in Audition, like some of the noise filters and rumble filters, things like that,
yeah.
where you can preview what it's going to sound like.
Yeah.
If you're not trying to spend
like,
a lot of
like
time,
what,
you can just adjust those sliders until it sounds good to you, and then you're done.
Yeah, I mean, that's like what kind of came up earlier, is with any of these pro applications, you can highlight an area and it'll just loop it, and you can change these settings and it immediately changes how it sounds. So you can kind of, I don't want to say figure it out, but you can customize it to what you need. Yeah, certainly. Even for me as an engineer, I mean, you tend to, you know, I can hear something and have a better idea of specifically what I need to do, but there's still always some degree of trial and error of dialing it into the right setting to get the desired result. It's just kind of the nature of the beast for this stuff.
Did you get blood today?
I did, yes.
Excellent. Thank you for that.
You get a free t-shirt.
The t-shirts are pretty
totally
awesome this year, I think.
Yeah, they're really good.
Not that they aren't always, but I think they're extra awesome this year. So I wish I could give blood because I want a t-shirt, damn it.
Take blood.
You can give platelets and plasma. You can do like, well, if you've got O blood, O negative, they do a special thing on you. Anyway, he actually took my question, but
oh no!
I was going to ask you what your signal chain was, and but since you pretty much set it EQ gate,
or at least that's the order I tend to recommend. I mean, as a baseline, that's what I pretty much universally use some variation of, certainly.
Yeah. Do you, well, I guess then my only question is, do you use any outboard gears?
I don't personally. You can. I mean, it certainly tends to be more of a financial investment, and you're getting usually, you know, what you're recording has already been processed, so you don't have a lot of flexibility to change some of that. But if you can set it up right, I mean, it can make things pretty much, you know, stupid simple. Hit record, you know, do your thing, stop, you're done, you know.
Yeah.
But I don't personally, but I resisting the urge of gear acquisition syndrome, let's just put it that way.
Right.
Where now?
What podcasts do you do? What do you work on?
Actually, I'm a audio engineer.
Sweet.
And musician for many years, but I'm not into podcasting yet.
Right.
But
come on in, the water's fine.
I'm into sound design and
awesome
music. So, but anyway.
That's great.
Thank you.
Thank you for your question. Thank you for also giving blood.
No problem.
So I didn't have to.
Jared with Howard Saxon, Geek.io, Depot Network. I've got a question about semi-portable audio gear. Do you guys have any recommendations on a compressor that is not necessarily rack-mounted, but also not terribly expensive? I've got one host that it's not my technique. I could probably train him like a monkey to do this as he's yelling, but it'd be hard.
Right, yeah.
He is a very large...
Even as a pro, I mean, yeah, I try not, because that just becomes such a pain.
Yeah,
and then if you go too far back, the microphone, you know, any good microphone will tend to, you'll tend to cut out if you're not careful.
Right.
Yeah,
right. But he has a very large range and volume. he's used to working on improv on stage.
Oh, okay. If you work in theater, improv,
projects.
Yeah.
Right. So it's
I kind of tend to do that too, but so I get it.
Are there any
dial it back
anything
a little
like that that's not necessarily rack mounted, but still a decent computer.
There is one I can think of. It's not rack mount first. It's actually designed to be a 1/3 rack mount unit. So essentially, you put three next to each other and you have the size of a proper rack mount. I can't remember the price tag. It's not super cheap, but it's FMR Audio, really nice compressor, and it pretty much lives up to the name.
That's the name of it.
Yeah, it's hilarious. It is the most they make the most ghetto looking equipment, but it's ghetto because they're putting all the money into making it sound good. So I can I can totally respect that. Okay, yeah, it's not terribly bad, but it's not, you know, certainly cheaper than alternatives, but it's at least more compact than carrying around a big, you know, rack mount, certainly.
I'd love to get
fun. Great question. We got time for one more question. So you're lucky contestant. Wait.
Oh,
my
God.
I was going to say, couldn't you just look up when he's just shouting real loud?
Right. Just look up. Yeah, just like, what's up?
Well, it's interesting because I have that problem, too, when I get excited when we're on him. I'm Mike Capus.
That's the case with anybody. Yeah. Even the pros. I mean, it's.
But we are from the Mythwits. We're actually a video podcast.
Yeah.
Blasphemy.
Live.
Witchcraft. No, I'm just kidding.
Live. We turn on the stream. And
I've done
edit
video
the stream,
stuff.
And there's no editing of the sound.
Sure.
However, we also do, like, we come here and we do video, and I go back home and I am going to edit it in Premiere. And am I committing any kind of audio sins if I'm just going to bring in the effects and do my things with the pieces in Premiere where I can just drop it in? Or do I really need to separate it out, take it into Audition? Or is it kind of like what I was thinking, is it the same? Is it kind of grabbing from the same?
I think, yeah, there probably is some shared code base. Do you have Creative Cloud or Creative Suite?
No, I just use the...
Or you're just
Creative
using
Suite.
The standard. Okay, yeah, so you have...
Mm-hmm.
At least Audition then.
But
the nice thing
sometimes
is,
I don't, it's
is
like
they are, ass. It's not like you have to export it and import it and then do your thing. And then, I mean, because it's all part of the same suite, there is some integration as far as round tripping. It's like, okay, send the audio to Audition and to edit it. So you can bring it back. It's a little bit more seamless than it would otherwise be.
Yeah, I've done it before.
It is more work, certainly.
But I mean, I have the high pass, the low
pass.
Everything's
ultimately, again,
so
if you're happy with the result, I mean,
I don't know.
There isn't.
Make up your mind.
You
that's the answer.
I don't know.
there's never, that's the thing about this stuff, there isn't really a wrong answer. Yeah. There are better answers than others sometimes.
One of our biggest problems
there,
and we've already, we definitely have sins already, because we're using wireless mics. Yeah, I heard guys talking about the wireless mics.
I'm not dissing wireless mics, I'm dissing these wireless mics.
But don't, you know, you gotta remember, we're walking through, we're covering parties, we are in a loud place.
Sure.
Showing, you know, their music, and I'm back, and he's walking through talking, and I'm filming him and stuff. And it works out when I bring it in and I'm looking at it. The sound is not bad. The wireless mic we use is not too bad.
Right.
Or just a, you know, a little,
just like a handheld.
Yeah.
It's it's a Bluetooth. You put the receiver on your camera.
Oh, one of those. Interesting.
Yeah, it's not bad.
So it's not a traditional UHF type of deal.
Interesting. I think it's great.
Yeah. I mean, and as long as he's up on it, I mean, loud music, and we can still hear him, and it's doable. But when I do try and kind of bring some of those, that music stuff out of the background, it still is. You know, I can never get it where I'm happier than just, screw it, just leave it, you know? So,
well, I think for something like that, when you're any sort of live event, you kind of already have a lot of forgiveness, because the ambience of the event, whether, no matter what it is kind of adds to the experience of listening. It doesn't have to be, you know, it doesn't have to sound like you're in a whisper booth, you know, so.
Okay.
Excellent, thank you. I'm glad it's working out well for you. That's interesting. What's the brand of that?
It's a Canon, right? Oh, he's got it.
Also, while we're waiting on that, be sure
show and tell time.
Right. Be sure if you had a good time to rate this this panel on the DragonCon app.
I hope I have not rambled incoherently too much.
We tried to keep him in line. Nobody give this guy a Red Bull. And true story.
Ever.
And what
you
is this?
You weren't even there.
That's nice.
Oh, wait, yeah, you were.
Oh, yeah, you were. Yeah, I like that. That's nice.
That's cool, yeah.
But
and
dude,
Bluetooth has enough range for that.
Oh, yeah.
Unless you're going way far away, but I mean, for what you're doing,
300 feet clear.
For reporter style stuff, I mean, yeah.
Not bad. All right, excellent. Thank you guys so much, John.
Thank you for putting up with my crap.